Father, thank you for your word tonight, and we just pray as we look into it, we might have perception about what's here, understanding about it, and the clarity that it can give in our ministry in Christ's name. Amen. Mark chapter number 10. We're down to the story of what's called the rich young ruler. Verse number 17, he came, when he, that's Jesus, had gone forth and into the way, there came one running and kneeled to him and asked him, "Good master, what shall I do that I may inherit eternal life?" Now, if you look at this parallel passage in Matthew and in Luke, you find he's a Pharisee that comes. He's not just a kid that's coming up to Christ. He's somebody who has some understanding, and he's more of a guy like Nicodemus. He comes, you notice the enthusiasm, he comes, he's running, he's kneeling, he's asking him. So there's this intensity, the humility to kneel, the courage to come to start with. And verse 21, it says, Jesus, beholding him, loved him. So when this incident occurs, you need to keep in mind, this is not like back in the first part of the chapter where someone's coming to tempt him. This is not someone coming to try to trap him. This is a genuine seeker coming to Christ, more or less like Nicodemus did, coming by night in John 3. He's someone who's genuinely come with an interest and a curiosity to know things. And Christ looks at him and he loves him, he has compassion on him. And by the way, sometimes people say there's nobody in the Gospels that Jesus actually says he loved him. Here's one. And the idea is Jesus wasn't turned off by him. And so you read it, you have to think about the fact that there's a sincere quest and coming to Christ. This is not a phony thing. The man's going to be a picture of the nation Israel. And sort of like the Romans 10, 2 and 3, they have a zeal of God but not according to knowledge. And going about to establish their own righteousness, they've not submitted themselves to the righteousness of God. He's sort of that kind of a guy. And he's going to picture what's going on in Israel in response to the ministry of Christ. Verse number 17, he says, "Good master, what shall I do that I may inherit eternal life?" Now, you know, we talked about that, and I think we have already talked about it. He says, "Good master." And Jesus instantly says to him, "Why callest thou me good? There's none good but one, that is God." In other words, if you're not saying I'm God, what are you saying I'm good for? And if you're saying I'm good, then are you recognizing me as God? Now, they knew the Messiah was going to be God. Jeremiah 23, they know he's going to be Jehovah, our righteousness, and so forth. So they understood that the Messiah would be the incarnation of Jehovah. And he says, "Is that who you say? Are you confessing me to be the Messiah? Is that what you're doing?" And that's a sort of a challenge to what he's doing. And it really cuts to the heart of his problem. Because the problem is not going to be the doing and stuff. The problem is going to be where is his heart? And he's going to demonstrate that to you. And by the way, it's also a demonstration of Christ's deity. You know, he's not accepting. We aren't good. I was reading a thing today. I don't know how much you're following. I assume you're following what's going on in the world out there. But I was reading an article today by one of the proponents of doing away with the police departments, and they're discussing it and talking about it. And this guy is the fellow doing this is a very intelligent fellow. He's not just a rabble rouser. He's very thoughtful about what he's doing, and he has a very persuasive argument that he makes. And I'm reading it, but it's all based upon the conviction that there is that the community of people that you work with in life are really good at heart, and that you don't really need the police to instigate violence against people because they're really good at heart and there's no real problem. Now, the problem with that is that's the opposite of what the Bible says. You know, the Bible's very clear that our culture, our world, is composed of sinful people who are desperate, who have hearts that are desperately wicked. That's what government is about, is controlling it. And if you were a libertarian, one of the ways you would identify government and government power, and I love this expression, they call it the government claims and maintains a monopoly on violence. And you think about that, you say, what? But then when you think about the government says, you can't kill somebody, but we can. You can't incarcerate somebody against their will, but we can. And that's part of what government does, is they have the right, the authority, to hold somebody, but for just cause, not just arbitrarily. And when you think about the police action in that kind of a way, and these people say, well, nobody is ever going to need to be. Everybody's good. There's an old thing, it was the fatherhood of God and the brotherhood of man. If you watched any of the funeral proceedings just the last few days, that's basically what was being said, is that everybody's good, everybody's brothers, everybody needs to get along, and if we just all got along, we'd be in good shape. And that's a fundamental denial of human nature, of reality, and what life really is about. People say perception is reality. That's true for lost people, and it's true for Christians who act like lost people, think like lost people, but it's not true for a believer. Reality is truth. Truth is reality. Jesus said, thy word is truth. The basis of reality is in God's word. If you want to understand what's going on, that's the reason I've been saying to you, don't get caught up in conspiracy stuff. Because conspiracies are ideas, is it true, is it not? And it's always a guy trying, somebody trying to explain why they lost. You don't need to be looking at conspiracy. You know the reality of what's there. You're not out there with your perception trying to figure it out. You have reality-based understanding out of God's word that then you take into life. So instead of looking at your experience and saying, where is reality in it? You look at God's word and say, this is what truth is. This is what reality is. And now I can look at life not as a source of trying to figure, but it's a place to go apply reality. And that's the Bible viewpoint of life. I work out of an understanding of truth. So Christ is challenging this young guy about where is your head? More importantly, where is your heart in these things? Because he comes with all the right religious enthusiasm, and he asks the question, good master, well, are you saying that, I'm God? Is that what you're doing, or is this something else? So, he, by the way, he wants to inherit eternal life. Eternal life for Israel is an inheritance. And eternal life for Israel is resurrection life. It's the kingdom. God told Abraham, I'm going to give you a seed and a land, and they're going to be in that land forever. To be in the land forever, you have to have eternal life. So when they think about eternal life, they're thinking about possession. We think about being born again, have eternal life, dying, going to heaven. These people don't think about dying, going to heaven. Job says, I know that in my flesh I shall see God and be right here on the planet. That's the hope. That's the first book in the Bible ever written. And their hope was resurrection, but in the earth. And that's Israel's hope. And when they talk about inheriting eternal life, they're thinking about resurrection life in the kingdom. So he's wanting to be in the family that gets that. So verse number 19. Thou knowest the commandments. Do not commit adultery, do not kill, do not steal, do not bear false witness, defraud not, honor thy father and thy mother. And he answered and said unto him, Master, all these things have I done from my youth up. Obviously, he hadn't learned the lesson of the law. Because the law says, the law is the knowledge of sin. And if he'd been measuring his life by the law, what would have happened? He'd have come up and said, well, I hadn't done this one or hadn't done that one. And you look at him, you say, adultery, murder, stealing, bearing false witness, defrauding, honor. Those are easier things that you can just go do. I mean, sometimes you feel like murdering your kids, but you don't, because you're going to have grandkids maybe one day, and they're God's reward for not killing your kids. But, there are things that restrain you from these things. But that's why in the Sermon on the Mount, Christ, when he talks about the kingdom, he says it's not just killing them not doing, but it's, did you have it, if you had it in your heart, you've committed murder. Same with adultery and so forth. So there's really a heart issue that has to be brought up here. So Christ's going to deal, he's going to push the issue into the kingdom issue. Now he's got, the guy's got the old system down. He hadn't learned the lesson of it. Israel didn't learn the lesson of it. So here comes the next question. Master, all these things I've done from my youth. Well, like I said, you know better than that. But he just hadn't learned the lesson yet. Now, by the way, Christ doesn't, he didn't pound on him about it. He just takes him to the next level. Verse 21, Jesus, beholding him, loved him. And you know, by the way, that's only in Mark. And it's an interesting comment. The guy has completely, he's a complete blank about the real meaning of the law, the real meaning of the word. And Christ doesn't get, he doesn't get angry with him like he did back Mark 3 with the Pharisees. He loves him. And again, it's, they have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge. Going about to establish their own righteousness, it's like they're just blind to it. And he obviously is. And he said unto him, one thing thou lackest. Go thy way, sell whatsoever thou hast, and give to the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven, and come and take up the cross and follow me. And he said unto him, and he was sad at that saying, and went away grieved, for he had great possessions. My uncle used to say, he had great possessions, but really great possessions had him. He loved things. He loved the things that he had. If you look at verse 24, when Christ explains this, the disciples were astonished at his word, but Jesus answered again and said unto them, children, how hard is it for him that trusteth in riches to enter into the kingdom of God? So what was the guy trusting in? He was trusting in riches. You find his heart. His heart wasn't in God's word. It wasn't in Christ, his Messiah. It was in possessions. And what his mind is on is getting the possessions in the kingdom. But you remember the verse I've been trying to talk to you repeatedly about. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then these things come. And all along through here, that issue is there's a physical, literally, you guys know about this literal, physical, visible, earthly kingdom that's coming, but there's this spiritual component that has to be there first before you get your kingdom. And this is an illustration of somebody who doesn't get that at all and loves the physical, the earthly thing, but that's all where his heart was. So he goes away. Now, the issue, you can't miss in this passage. He comes and he says, what must I do to inherit eternal life? That's the question, that what must I do question. And when you see that, what Christ does, if you look over at Luke chapter 12, he tells him what they did in the kingdom program. Luke 12, verse 32, when he says, sell what you have, give it to the poor, and follow me. That's the message of becoming a member of the little flock. Luke chapter 12, verse number 32. I keep seeing people walk out of the darkness back there. It's kind of weird. Maybe I should turn those lights on so I can... Okay. When they appear out of the darkness, it's kind of... Well, it's teenagers, so they're not bad looking, but it's kind of weird. Luke chapter 12, verse 32. Fear not, little flock. Well, let's start in verse 31. But rather seek ye the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you. So there again, there's a spiritual component. Then you get the physical. Fear not, little flock. It is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Sell that you have and give alms. Giving alms is giving it to the poor. Provide yourselves bags which wax not old, a treasure in the heavens, that faileth not, where no thief approacheth, neither doth moth corrupt. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. So that's basically what he says. If you want to be a part of the little flock who's going to inherit the kingdom, you need to sell what you have, get completely cut ties with now. Why? Because in the tribulation that he's preparing them to go through, what happens if you don't take the mark of the beast? You can't buy or you can't sell. If physical possessions are the issue in your life, you're going to fall away. So there's a heart issue here. Come over to chapter 14, Luke 14. Luke 14, 33. So likewise, whosoever he be of you that forsaketh not all that he hath, he cannot be my disciple. So that selling out and forsaking, not holding on to now, because there's a kingdom come where you're going to get the real stuff. If you come over to Acts chapter 2, this explains for you what's going on in Acts 2. I'll have to try to be calm when I talk about this. The modern evangelical industrial complex, Big Eva, they call them, all these big evangelical megachurches and the organizations like Nine Marks and Gospel Coalition and all this outfits, they're into this big, the Southern Baptist Convention are doing it. They're big social warriors. They are woke. You heard that phrase? You got to be woke. You've got to become aware of the racial tensions that white privilege has destroyed. Is your wokeness, is you're aware of your white privilege. And they are woke, with capital letters, social warriors. And the idea is we're going to go out, and back 100 years ago it was called the social gospel. The modernists did it against the fun. Today it's you're back into the social gospel stuff. And I think about, what do you mean social gospel? We've got to take care of the poor, feed the poor, clothe the hungry. And I think, well, you know, in Galatians chapter 2, when Paul goes to Jerusalem and talks to the Pentecostal saints there, and they recognize his ministry, they have the meeting, they endorse him, and they say, remember the poor. Remember that verse, Galatians 2:10? And they just say, I don't know, or remember, they're talking about the poor saints in Jerusalem. Remember them. And Paul says, well, I've already done that, which I'm forward to do. It's the common activity of believers to have a mind and a heart for the poor and needy. That's a common kind of thing. And if believers don't do that, then they're not acting like believers, because that's a common kind of thing. Do good to all men, especially those of the household of faith. That's the standard for activity for believers. It isn't that you get all you can and count all you can get. That's not an attitude of grace or of a believer. So the idea that, well, you guys aren't doing something and it's because you're evil and wicked, it's just so foreign to, you know, just the common thinking. But there's a guy named Tim Keller. Have you heard of him? You guys are wonderfully ignorant. This is you don't know how encouraging it is to me that you don't know who these dudes are. Because they're evil seeds. He was the pastor of Redeemer Church in Manhattan, and he's got this big ministry. He has an article about this in which he says, and he is the only one that says this, but he's the one that's pushing it right now. Today is Wednesday. Monday I heard on our radio station some of the guys that are on 4 and 5 o'clock in the afternoon, these couple of young woke preachers, and they were quoting this article from Keller. And he literally says that in Galatians 2:14, Paul, when he stands Peter to the face because he was to be blamed, did it because Peter was a racist. And that he wouldn't eat with the Gentiles because he was racist. And I'm thinking, how much of a blasphemous nitwit can you be? Well, evidently a pretty good one. Blasphemy is to speak evil again. That's nonsense. But that's the standard understanding of modern evangelicalism about why the Pentecostal church was only Jewish. They teach, and this guy says, at Pentecost, it was completely Jewish, completely segregated. in the first few chapters of the book of Acts, completely segregated. Acts 11:19, they go as far as preaching to none but the Jews only. There were a bunch of, and God had to raise up Paul because of the racial bigotry of the 12 apostles. And I go, a big dose in this case of right division would help these guys, you know, give them some understanding of their Bible instead of. But what they're doing is they're trying to virtue signal and be. We're with it. It's got nothing to do with the Bible. But that's wicked stuff. It's mean stuff. It's bad stuff. And the reason I got saying that is I turned to Acts 2 and got it in my mind. I got it out of my craw, okay? But when you see that stuff, a good dose of understanding God's Word rightly divided would have helped save them from the stupidity and the deception that they are peddling everywhere, because these guys are heroes. And if you go into evangelicalism and you find a pastor under 40 years old, these are their mentors. These are the people they're following. These are the people they honor. These are the people they love. These are the people they quote. And if you go in grace circles outside of our network now, you know, we obviously you don't know who they are, which is good. Be simple concerned that which is evil, wise concerned that which is good. But if you get out in the people think evangelicalism out there has answers for you, then these are people that follow. The Gospel Coalition, Mark 9, Gospel for Today, G4T, whatever it's called, all these big organizations. These are monstrous organizations. Acts 29, all stuff. You guys, wow, I'm impressed. You don't know who they are. You're saying, why do I know? Because I keep watching for the dump truck coming down the road to run over you to warn you to get in the ditch. That kind of stuff is just, and the fruit of it is you get in a situation like we're in our culture with the sea changes going on, and they don't have a message that does any good. When I was raised, my dad used to say, there are three places there are no racial problems: heaven, hell, and the believer's heart. And outside of heaven and hell, the only other place is going to be in the heart of a believer who functions in the life of Christ. And that's the only place on the planet you're going to find it. Everywhere else is going to have it. Because men's hearts are desperately wicked, and prejudice and bigotry based on the color of people's skin or their money or their culture. People can find all kind of reasons not to like each other based upon the corruption of their own sin nature. A few months ago, one of the words that was going around so much was systemic. You know, the president is existential. He's an existential threat. You heard that about 30 times a day on the news. And I'm thinking, there's 30 different people saying this one word that nobody ever heard about 2 weeks ago. They didn't just come up with it. It's just somebody gave them the memo. Well, now there's systemic racism. It's the systemic old sin nature. That's the problem. Systemic, the word system, it's in the system. It's not in policing that's the problem. It's in the old sin nature doing the policing. You follow that? Where the systemic problem is in you and in me. And the only way to fix that is in Christ. Okay, God set up government. So the system isn't corrupt. It can be corrupted, but it's corrupted by the systemic corruption of the old sin nature. So you hear all that stuff and you just go, but see, these guys have no idea about it. They just right into it. And really, critical race theory, the woke social justice, really, that's just new skins for Marxism. Just like back in the 100 years ago, the social gospel was just a new skin, a current skin, for the Marxist philosophies that came out of the 1900s. And you look at that and you say, you can be simple about all that, but your Bible will correct it. So just stick with the things. The guy's told to sell all that he had. The fascinating thing is they do it. In Acts chapter 2, they're filled with the Holy Spirit. They weren't racist. They were filled with the Spirit, speaking as the Spirit gave them utterance. Okay? They were doing exactly what God's program was. They weren't racist because they were Jews and exclusively to Israel. That was God's program. It was through Israel all the nations of the earth are going to be blessed. And if they wanted the nations to be blessed, they had to get Israel the channel in its right position. This had nothing to do with racism. It had nothing to do with hating people because of their nationality, the color of their skin. It had to do with a doctrinal reason. But people that are vacuous about doctrinal things will never understand that. Acts 2, verse 42. And they continued steadfast in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and breaking of bread and prayers. And fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done. See God, see the fellowship they're having with one another? The Holy Spirit working with them? Verse 44, and all that believe were together and had all things common, and sold their possessions and goods, and parted them to all men, as every man had need. Now, why did they do that? Did that just come out of a committee meeting that says, well, you know, we need to take care of these poor people? No. That came because that's part of what Christ told them to do. Your home's not here, your home's in the kingdom. Your possessions aren't here, store them up in heaven, so when I come back, you bring rewards. You look at 1 Peter and see him talk about that. Revelation 22, he talks about that. They understood he's gone away to receive a kingdom, come back. That's where our hope is. That's where our eternal life is. And we've got to get through this tribulation. So the provisions are there. They're obeying what he said in chapter 4. Again, they're filled with the Spirit. Verse 31, 32, verse 31. And when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spake the word of God with boldness. So again, the Pentecost is repeated, and the multitude of them that believed were of one heart and one soul. Neither said any of them that all of the things which he possessed was his own, but they had all things common. And great power gave the apostles, with great power gave the apostles witness. Verse 34, neither was there any among them that lacked. For as many as were possessed of lands or houses sold them and brought the prices of the things that were sold and laid them down at the apostles' feet, and distribution was made unto every man according as he hath need. And the issues in chapter 5 and 6 revolve around that issue of selling it, bringing it, and distributing it. So this isn't racial issues. This is them obeying what God says, and they're doing it being filled with the Holy Spirit who causing them to carry out that program. Now, I know sometimes you say, well, you know, Richard, you talk about that stuff. It's important for you to understand it, because when all this emotional stuff comes along that completely overturns what Scripture's about, then you look at it. I don't want you to be confused about that. And as I said, a good dose of right division would help a lot of those people. And by the way, I'm giving it to them on the radio this coming week. So been doing it in the past too, but I'm making some special programs this week about some of this stuff. Go back to Mark chapter 2. Go with me to Luke chapter. You're in Luke chapter 4. This "what must I do" question. Luke chapter 3. This question shows up in your Bible several times, and it's a fascinating question. It's fascinating the way it's answered. In Luke chapter 3, John the Baptist comes on the scene, verse number 2, and Ananias and Caiaphas, being the high priest, the word of God came unto John, the son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. And he came into all the country about Jordan, preaching the baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. He comes preaching the gospel of the kingdom. You know that title from Matthew 4. As he does that, verse number 7, then he said to the multitude that came forth to be baptized of him, so he's gathering a crowd of people that are listening to him. And the Pharisees come, the generation of vipers and so forth that he's talking about then. Now verse 10, after he's told the Pharisees these things, he said, the people ask him in verse 10, the people ask him, saying, what shall we do? I mean, you just told those guys they're going to be burned up. So if wrath is coming, what do we do to flee from the wrath to come? You see in verse 7, Then he said unto the multitude that came forth to be baptized from, O generation of vipers, who hath warned you to flee from the wrath to come? How do we flee from God's coming wrath? What shall we do? Verse 11, he answered and said unto them, he that hath two coats, let him impart to him that hath none, and he that hath meat, let him do likewise. Now, I don't know about you, but I've listened to a lot of preaching in the last 50 years. I never heard anybody say that when somebody says, what do I have to do to miss the wrath of God? I was downtown not long ago. Well, now it's a long time ago. But, you know, this is the longest in about 40 years that I haven't traveled. I haven't been anywhere since February. It's weird. I told my wife yesterday, I said, I need to start traveling so I can get my life back together. We've been so doggone busy because I've been home so much. But I was downtown sometime last year, and they're at the train station. They rode the train down, and there's a guy standing outside, and he's got a big sign, repent, turn or burn. But he didn't have that on it. I mean, what kind of instruction? How do you miss the wrath of God by doing that? Anybody ever said that to anybody? No, I hadn't either. Verse 12, then came the publicans to be baptized and said unto him, Master, what shall we do? And again, what shall we do to flee from the wrath to come? And he said unto them, exact no more than that which is appointed you. Don't overtax somebody. That's what's going to take you to get in heaven. Is that what you tell your clients? No. I know he doesn't. No. And the soldiers likewise demanded, saying, and what shall we do? And he said unto them, do violence to no man. Neither curse any, accuse any falsely, and be content with your wages. There's that violence thing. Those are all works, aren't they? How are we going to flee from the wrath to come? Do these works. If you go back to Isaiah 33 and you'll see about that wrath to come, the abiding in the fire, these are exactly the same things he says. You know what the little flock's going to do? They're going to do these things, and these things. That's how they're going to minister. Who is it that's going to, that righteous nation is going to? But I tell you what, somebody says, Richard, how do you miss the wrath to come? I don't say that. I made 3 radio programs today telling people how to miss the wrath to come. I didn't say that at all. Well, what right do I have to say it different if that's what God sent? He's a man sent from God. Come with me to Acts chapter 3. By the way, I don't say what Jesus said. Somebody says, what must I do to inherit eternal life? I don't say, sell what you have and give it to the poor. I mean, I might say, what do the commandments say to make him understand he's a sinner? But I don't then say, okay, one more thing. You got to keep it. No, I don't do that at all. Well, what right do you have to do that? I mean, you see, salvation is as simple as it can be. When you get in the Bible, it's not really that simple. In Acts chapter 2, verse number 23, him, talking about Jesus, being delivered by the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God, you have taken and by wicked hands have crucified and slain, whom God hath raised up, having loosed the pains of death, because it is not possible that he should be holden. Now that's not good news to them. You crucified the Messiah, and God raised him up. What do you think God raised him up for? Verse 34. For David is not ascended into the heavens, but he saith himself, the Lord said unto my Lord, sit thou at my right hand until I make thy foes thy footstool. He's gone away, and he's going to be there until the Father sends him back to burn up his enemies. By the way, that verse is it's interesting the way it's used. In Psalm 110, verse 1, back there it says, to make his enemies his footstool. Here it says his foes. Now, that's the same thing in a sense, and in a sense it's not. An enemy is an enemy, a foe is an enemy, but a foe is an active enemy. He's more than just your enemy. He's somebody who is engaging in enemy activity against you. That's what Israel's done. They've rejected, they've crucified him. Now, there is an act. They've literally declared war on God the Father. We read that verse, we went to that Psalm 2 Sunday night. They've declared war against Jehovah and his anointed. Well, verse 36, therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God hath made the same Jesus whom you've crucified, both Lord and Christ. He'll either be your Savior or he'll be your judge. He's going to be the Lord that you stand before, or he'll be the Christ, the anointed one, your Savior. You got two choices. Look down to verse 40. And with many other words did he testify, exhorting, saying, save yourselves. Now, wait a minute. I thought you couldn't save yourself. Did you ever have anybody pull that verse on you when you're talking to them? Well, keep talking to people. They will. I've had them. Save yourself. Well, preacher, you just said I can't save myself. Peter, on the day of Pentecost, filled with the Holy Spirit, speaking the Spirit, gave him out, said, save yourself. Save yourself from what? From this untoward generation. That's that, isn't that a wonderful word, untoward? Your Bible's got such great language. If you're going toward something, if you're untoward, you're not going toward it anymore. It's the opposite of going toward something. You're going away. Here's this generation in Israel that's turned their backs and gone away from the Lord. And the wrath of God, Luke 11, Matthew 23, the wrath of God, this generation upon which his wrath is going to be poured. And he said, you need to save yourself from that generation, going to that tribulation, having the wrath poured on them, and the fire burning them up, the baptism of fire. Now, how do they turn? What words does he exhort them? Look at verse 28, verse 27. Now, when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart. They got convicted. And said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Now, there's the same question. It's come up three times now. Well, more than that if you count the three in Luke, four. But three different settings. They asked John the Baptist, what should we do? He asked Christ, what should we do? Now, we're asking Peter. Now, here's John the Baptist sent by God the Father. Here's Jesus Christ, who is God the Son. And here's Peter filled with God the Holy Spirit. So we're getting three instructions from the Godhead and their representatives. That ought to be powerful. That ought to be persuasive. What shall we do? Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Now that's pretty clear. Repent. Turn around, change your mind. Be baptized. Change your mind about Jesus. You crucified the Messiah. Change your mind about who he is. And be submit to the baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. Now, in case you don't understand that for the remission of sins thing, that's not repent and be baptized because you have received the remission of sins already. That's repent and be baptized so you can get your sins remitted. For in the sense of gaining them. People come along, they use what we used to call the ice bag. The Greek preposition for is the word ice. Epsilon, iota, sigma. And it's a preposition that shows direction. It's used in the accusative case. And it would be for in the direction of the remission of sins. And they would say, well, see, that means it's because he got it. I say, well, that didn't necessarily mean that. It could mean for, not just because he had it, but to get it. So you need another verse that helps you with it. Greek language doesn't really help you. But if you look at chapter 3, verse 19, there's a verse right there in your Bible you didn't need to know anything about Greek that tells you. 3:19, repent you therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out. When are their sins going to be blotted out? When the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord, and he shall send Jesus. That's the second coming. Now, that's exactly what Jeremiah 31 tells them in the New Covenant. That's what Isaiah 59 tells them in the New Covenant. That's what Paul quotes in the New Covenant, Revelation, Romans chapter 11, verse 27 and 28. This is my covenant with them when I shall take away their sins, talking about when the Messiah comes. Israel, their day of atonement is at the second coming. I've never told anybody any of this stuff. You say, well, you're not, what, there's the Godhead. Why don't you tell them that? Well, the reason I don't is because if you come over to Acts 16, another guy got asked this question. And he answers it really differently. Acts 16, verse number 30. Then brought them out, verse 16, 29, then he called for a light and sprang in, talking about the jailer, and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas and brought them out and said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? Now that's basically the same question, isn't it? In fact, it's exactly the same question. And Paul doesn't say, treat your neighbor right. Don't cheat on your taxes. He doesn't say, keep the commandments. He doesn't say, repent and be baptized. He says, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. You ever told anybody that you don't have to do, there's only one thing you have to do to be saved? Repent and be repent and believe. If you got to repent and believe, how many is that? That's every track you'll see. I pick up tracks around here. People leave all the time looking at them. And they'll say, okay, I'll give you the gospel, give it all to you. And then they say, what you need to do is repent and believe. Because Mark 1 says, repent and believe the gospel. And they go back over to Mark, to John's ministry, and say, repent and believe the gospel. Well, I can count. Not real well. You know, I've told you the only class I ever flunked was a math class. Algebra. Repent and believe is two things. Don't tell me I don't have to do anything. I only have to do one thing to get saved, then tell me to do two things. You follow that? He says, believe. You don't have to do two things, you just have to do one. You don't have to do three things. You don't have to repent, be baptized. And so one thing. To him that works not, but believeth on him that justifieth the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness. Now, what right, think about this, what right did Paul have to change the program? John gave Israel's program. Jesus gave Israel's program. Peter gave Israel's program. They're all real clear. But you get this outlier guy over here, and he's different. And the reason he's different is because he was different. He had a different program. Peter says it in Acts 3:21. He's preaching that which is spoken by the mouth of all the holy prophets since the world began. John was the fulfillment. He's sent from God as a man sent from God with the word from God. He's the fulfillment of Malachi 3. Jesus is the Messiah. He is the word of God. Peter is speaking by the mouth of the Holy Holy Spirit, and he's preaching about all the things from the prophetic program is embodied in what they're doing. Paul said he's preaching Jesus Christ, but according to the revelation of the mystery, which was kept secret since the world began. But now it's been two entirely different programs. So when you're thinking about salvation, and as we study Mark, and we talk about the kingdom, understand this is not the program that God has in effect today. We're in a different program, and if you leave our program where it is, and don't try to confuse the two, then Mark can mean something to you that it never could any otherwise. But if you're always trying, and this is what preachers do, to take this stuff and put it on us and put us back on it, you wind up being a woke social worker that is like a blind bat flying backwards in a dark cave, doesn't know what he's doing. So it's important to grasp why these things are different, and not just grasp that they are, but why it's important to know that they are. We live in a world struggling in the midst of the works of darkness, the works of the darkness of untruth. And we're to put on the armor of light, the light of the truth of God's word. But if you can't rightly divide God's word, you're never going to have any light. I picked up a boys love flashlights. Have you ever noticed that? You buy a girl a doll, buy a boy a flashlight or a model car. And I was looking for a flashlight the other night, and it dawned on me, oh, my grandson took it. I gave it to him. He didn't take it, but he took it after I gave him to it. But he never brought it back. So I finally found one in my drawer, and I got it out, and I flicked it on, and the light came on, but it was so dim, I couldn't see. And I got it on, I put it on my watch to try to illuminate the little doojiggers on it that light up, and it wouldn't even light them up. A dim light doesn't help too much, but it's better than nothing. But you get in a dark world and little lights. And I actually, even though that light wouldn't light my watch, it helped me from falling over my feet when I went to the bathroom in the middle of the night. So little lights are important. So be a light, but be a good bright light. And the light of the gospel, the light of the truth of God's word. We live in a world filled with darkness. And it's the darkness of unbelief. They've thrown God's word out. And you're going to reap what you sow when you do that. But there are people out there looking for answers and for truth. So fly the flag. Okay? It's nice seeing you in this nice little setting. This is kind of cozy. You know, not enough seats for Sunday, but it's kind of cozy for tonight. Move all of you backbenchers up here. We can see the whites of your eyes. There are people with masks on back there. Now they're not. I checked them out. They're not armed. I checked them when they came in, but we hadn't seen them in a while. But we still hadn't seen them. I think. All right, Father, we thank you tonight for your love and your grace. We thank you for your word. Most of all, we thank you for our Son, your Son, our Savior, and that we share him together. We've been reconciled to you in one body, reconciled to you and to one another because of him. And we thank you for that privilege. And we pray that we might have and take advantage of opportunities to share your love, your grace, to touch others with that love and concern that you have so that your life and your love might be honored. We thank you in Christ's name.